The user-centered design and its application to BCI development demands for close investigation of the end user's needs and requirements and of the restrictions that come along with their diseases. The latter restrictions may range from small artifact contamination of the recorded brain signal up to loss of perception modalities. For example, loss of ocular control is often the case with progression of neurodegenerative diseases. Furthermore, attention allocation may be limited and long-lasting training sessions may be too demanding. BCIs are required to accommodate for such restrictions and to offer appropriate solutions, such as switching to auditory or tactile modalities when vision is impaired. Many of these restrictions are not evident when testing systems with healthy users. Furthermore, a system in daily use has to meet other requirements than a system developed for research purpose only, for example with regard to hardware setup, software handling and technical support. Bringing BCI technology to end users' homes thus, inevitably requires involving them into this developmental processes. More recently, the potential user of a BCI came more into the focus of BCI development and user-centered approaches were adopted. A user-centered approach implies early focus on users, tasks and environment, the active involvement of users, an appropriate allocation of function between user and system, the incorporation of user-derived feedback into system design, and an iterative process whereby a prototype is designed, tested and modified. The user-centered approach was standardized with the International Organization for Standardization, ISO, 9241-210, Ergonomics of Human-System Interaction, Part 210, Human-Centered Design for Interactive Systems. According to this approach, three kinds of requirements have to be taken into account. 1. Business requirements. Here, typically, a specific number is set in terms of how many systems should be sold in a defined time frame. Although our face speller and brain painting, see below, have already been adopted by a company, http://www.intendix.com/, and are thus, available on the market, these products are not yet suitable for daily use in the field. 2. User requirements and functional specification. BCI requirements need to be specified from a user's point of view, including the functions required to support a user's tasks, the user system and interfaces. Usability goals that must be achieved and the approach for system maintenance at the user's home need to be defined. 3. Technical requirements. It has to be specified how the system will achieve the required functions and what data structure must be available for internal processing for the approach to be successful. Technical constraints need to be defined, such as the maximum data communication speed over a network or the trade-off between good EEG measurement and comfort with regards to the EEG cap. On the basis of these requirements, Zickler and colleagues asked experts in using assistive technology, at, i.e. people with severe motor impairment, what they would consider the most important requirements for BCI. Those requirements were functionality, independent use, and easiness of use. See section on user-centered improvements of BCI-controlled applications. Two different approaches to BCI control were subject of evaluation following these standards. BCIs dependent on modulation of sensory-motor rhythms, referred to as SMR-BCI, and on detection of event-related potentials, referred to as ERP-BCI. To better understand the applications and their evaluation, we provide a condensed description of the SMR and ERP-BCI as implemented for control of the specific applications described below. BCIs can be established by detecting an active modulation of sensory-motor rhythms, SMR, over sensory-motor areas of the brain. In a resting state, these rhythms are highly synchronized in the alpha, 10 to 12 Hz, and beta, 12 to 30 Hz, bands. When moving or imagining a movement, these rhythms desynchronize, i.e. the power of these frequency bands can actively be modulated by the user. Thus, SMR modulation constitutes a signal for BCI control. Different classes of motor imagery can be selected depending on a user's individual brain signals and the degrees of freedom that are required for control of an application. In a typical SMR-BCI, users trigger control signals for two classes by either imagining movement of the right or the left hand. Feedback is provided during the imagery tasks to enhance participants' performance, thereby reinforcing correct behavior. As hand areas are largely separated in the sensory-motor cortex, the evoked patterns are usually well distinguishable. Importantly, it has been shown that people with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis can utilize such modulations of the SMR to operate a BCI. One of the remaining issues, however, is that a large number of participants is not able to achieve sufficient SMR-BCI performance. BCI systems that do not rely on such active modulations of brain signals are available. The most frequently used system is described in the next section. A typical BCI based on event-related potentials is the so-called P300 Speller, providing muscle-independent communication on a character-by-character basis, for recent reviews, and a character matrix is displayed on a computer screen and groups of characters, usually rows and columns in a matrix, are highlighted, flashed, in random order. Users focus their attention on the desired field of the matrix, the target, by counting the number of flashes whilst ignoring all other characters, non-targets. This pattern constitutes an oddball paradigm as target flashes are rare, odd, as compared to the high amount of non-target flashes. For example, in a 6x6 matrix, one row and one column contains the target character, whereas five rows and five columns are to be ignored. Each stimulus triggers distinct event-related potentials, among which the P300 usually is the most prominent. It is a positive deflection in the EEG which occurs roughly around 300 milliseconds post-stimulus. Its latency may strongly vary with paradigms and across individuals, for review. Yet other ERPs are also elicited, therefore a time window of up to 1000 milliseconds post-stimulus, typically 800 milliseconds, is recommended to investigate users' individual ERPs, i.e., negative and positive deflections at distinct latencies. The characteristic sequence of event-related potentials is identified for each row and each column. The row and column with the most prominent ERPs are selected and the respective letter appears on the screen. It has been shown that 72.8% of N equals 81 healthy BCI users were able to communicate with 100% accuracy by means of such an ERP BCI and that less than 3% could not achieve any control. Importantly, these results transfer to individuals with severe motor impairment, for example due to neurodegenerative disease, in that the Speller can be utilized as a muscle-independent tool for communication, for example, for review. Since its first description in 1988, the P300 Speller has been used intensively, further investigated and modified in a plethora of research publications leading to new applications for communication and device control, for review, for example.